Hi, should I start?
Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Nihar Gokhale. I'm a journalist based in Delhi. I have been covering environmental policy, land rights, resources for about 5 years now. And especially over the last 1 year, I've been associated with Land Conflict Watch and have focused on land rights stories, which I typically report from villages around the country. Who wants to go next? Raksha.
Sure. My name is Raksha. I am an independent journalist, and I report, at least for the last 4 or 5 years, I've reported from both Schedule 5, Schedule 6 areas on land rights, and that's been the focus. Trying to understand land and its intrinsic kind of relationship with identity. So yeah, and recently have been branching out and looking and focusing more on women's land rights. Nihar, you're on mute.
Oh, sorry. I was saying Monica and then Kunal, maybe you guys introduce yourselves.
Yeah, sure. Hi, my name is Monica. I'm an independent journalist, and actually, with Impact Journalism Grant, that was the first time I was looking specifically on land rights issues. And I'm telling these stories from women's perspective. And all my stories have been about either Adivasi or Dalit women.
Very nice. Kunal.
Hi everyone, my name is Kunal Purohit. I'm an independent journalist based out of Bombay. I report for different national and international publications, and I largely look at issues of development at various intersections, be it politics, be it the rise of right-wing politics, be it gender, be it agriculture. So I try and do a mix of these issues, and I report extensively from the hinterlands. So right from the hinterlands of Maharashtra to Uttar Pradesh to Jharkhand. I've been traveling quite a bit in the last 2 years, especially. And I hope that some of those insights gained from the ground might be interesting to share on this platform.
Thanks, Kunal. So I think how we'll go about this is let's each one of us take about 5 to 7 minutes to talk about a story that we covered from the field and which brings out some of the complexities around land in India. So, Raksha, would you like to start?
So there was a whole range of stories that I worked on specifically, around 2015, 16, because there was a lot of focus back then. The Niti Aayog was focusing on urbanization. There was the Smart City Mission, where this particular central government was interested in having 100 smart cities scattered over the entire country. So my focus back then was to essentially understand the process of urbanization and then approach the idea of land rights from that prism. And one of the stories that I did back then was from a whole host of, let me just check this, about 16 to 18, depending on how you count it, villages around Ahmedabad. And these villages were protesting, their inclusion into the Ahmedabad Urban Development Authority. So the Urban Development Authorities in most cities, as everybody knows, is acts as a municipality or works in coordination with the municipality. So either way, these are decision-making bodies, and these are bodies that are trying to implement quote-unquote urban ideas within their jurisdiction. So the minute a particular village is taken into the urban development authority's fold, the projects are then decided by that particular authority. It becomes, for all practical purposes, a village becomes a city on paper. And the minute that happens, the programs, the way a government looks at a particular piece of land changes. And one of the more visible changes is when agricultural lands become, anything else really. They can turn into industries, a lot of the lands that I kind of surveyed in these areas were becoming resorts, luxury resorts. They were becoming large, you know, water parks. And Ahmedabad, as we know, is one of those cities where water has been a constant issue. So in essence, these were villagers who were protesting the taking over of their lands into the urban development authorities. Now, what is curious is that this is not the first time, although this is the first time they were protesting in Gujarat, cities across central and southern Gujarat, so Junagadh, Bhavnagar, Surat, a lot of Morbi, a lot of these cities have seen something similar happen to them. So they expand and kind of take a lot of villages into their fold. And I think the reason why it's important for us to talk about this particular story today, and this is not a Gujarat-centric phenomenon at all, as we all know, Gujarat model is something which has become rather infamous and which is something that is being, you know, spread across the country. And the reason why we should talk about it today is because of the kind of disturbing images we see every day of migrants trying to walk back to their villages thousands of kilometers away. So the idea of a city per se is very, very different. And if you actually have a group of villagers who do not want to be called urban residents, then there is a specific reason for that. One of the main reasons that we see both in Gujarat and in Bihar, where a lot of such similar policies are being implemented, is that they say that their loss of land is a main concern. I want to just tie the idea of loss of land to this idea of migrants that we just touched upon. And a very, the base or the foundation of these two ideas is identity. So these villagers actually identify themselves with their land. So they are saying, we'd much rather be called villagers. We'd much rather do our agriculture. They're very, very fertile lands. They grow a lot of cash crops. Then, you know, be part of the city, give up 40% of their lands into this larger pool that the government is making, and lose their identity. And I think that is the crux of the issue. The reason why a lot of the migrants are walking back is also a huge reason, is that the city doesn't need them anymore. So they don't identify themselves with the city. A lot of the government subsidies are there in the place of origin, which is their village. And they, they're kind of fly-by-night visitors in the city, and therefore they'd much rather go back. So I think looking at this, reporting this story in 2015 and kind of looking back at it now makes a lot of sense in terms of how a lot of the villagers are actually resisting their inclusion into cities. And like Nihar pointed out earlier in a personal communication, there is a very interesting piece in the Mint today, which talks about how the government should probably look at newer development models, going forward in the post-COVID world. When we look at, you know, fewer cities or fewer larger metropolises, and look at urbanization not necessarily as a development tool. We can definitely come back and talk about this, Nihar, in the scenario of the COVID crisis. But at this point, I'll stop here so, you know, we can have like a more greater discussion and, you know, later.
Sure. After we are all done with our presentations, we'll open up for discussions and also take questions from the audience. Monica, would you like to talk about your stories?
Sure. So what I would like to do is just read the story for you and then we can talk. Yeah. So this story is called, I asked for my land, they called me a witch. It was a Navaratri night in October 2016. Ratnibin Babur was walking back home. Her village Borwa wore a festive look, but she sensed something was different in the dark. The roof had fallen down. All I could see was stones and blood. She ran in. My husband's face was bleeding profusely. My pregnant daughter was lying on the floor, holding her stomach and crying. My son looked very scared, she says. Some of Ratnibin's family has branded her a Dakan, a witch. The attack on her house was part of the witch hunt carried out by them. That night, her husband's nephew came with five others from the extended family to pelt her house with stones. She believes they had come to kill her. Labeling a woman a witch is not uncommon in Ratnibhen's Bhil Adivasi community. The offensive against her started many years ago when she and her husband decided to settle down in their own village. For years, they had worked as manual laborers in cities across Gujarat. Her husband's brother joined in the attack when her father-in-law died in June 2016. They called her a witch and accused her of eating him up. A month later, a brother-in-law passed away. They blamed her again. Over the years, Ratnibhen has been blamed for illnesses in the extended family, hitches in marriages, problems during religious ceremonies, poor crop yield, dying goats and chickens, and even bad rains. Finally, Ratnibhen's husband died in June 2017. Even as she was mourning his death, the family held her responsible for it. And this was not even an isolated incident of violence. This is my lifelong grief. There is so much sorrow inside. I don't know what to remember and what to forget, Ratnibhen says. She approached the Panch, the local community court. They never supported me because I'm a woman. Also, men bribe them with alcohol and money, she says. Since her husband's death, the tormentors' jibes have forced Ratnibhen to keep her head covered, a sign of a widow's modesty and submission. It pierces my heart. It causes both pain and anger, she says. Women branded as witches are often subject to extreme violence. Between 2001 and 2017, over 2,600 persons have been killed. And the NCRB data doesn't even count cases like Ratnibhen's, since no murder is involved. Most victims are women. The new wave of witch hunting is linked to how resource-stressed Adivasis are and how low their access to land is. 4 out of 5 rural landless families are Adivasis, and their average land holding size is only 1.5 hectares. This creates pressure on these families, and they sometimes use witch hunting as a tactic to oust the most vulnerable from the land, and that is single women. It doesn't reflect well on a family to mistreat a woman, but once she is labeled a Dakin, the society wouldn't care even if she's killed. Sejal Dand of Anandi, a nonprofit that works in Gujarat, says, the state is the biggest culprit here. There have been no land reforms or proper distribution of revenue or forest land to Adivasis. The state has been lax also in tackling non-Adivasi encroachment over Adivasi land and in also updating land records. Most tribes in Gujarat don't recognize women's customary right to inherit land from either a parent or husband. So when it comes to land rights, Bhil women in Gujarat face double marginalization as Adivasis and also as women. So within 2 weeks of her husband's death, Ratnibhen started the process of updating her name in the land record. She was clueless about it, which offices to visit, which forms to ask for, how to fill them. She can't write. An NGO and its paralegals helped her. But there was a battle she had to fight all by herself. She had to get NOCs from her extended family, and she required 80 of them. It took her over 45 days of running around, and there were fights every day. Her son asked her to drop the matter, but she didn't. Finally, in September 2018, Ratnibhen got her name added in the land records. Now she cultivates 4.5 bighas of land. This is 2.5 bighas more than she used to cultivate before. The 2 bigha of mango, lemon, and guava orchard has been particularly profitable for her. Her savings, keeping aside the input cost and family expenses, added up to 60,000 rupees last year, which is a sizable sum for her. She shows the orchard with a quiet pride, and she is particularly pleased with the size of mangoes this year. With her name in the record, she has also been able to claim 4,000 rupees of the annual 6,000 of the central government offers to farmers under the PM Kisan scheme. She got her daughter's name also added in the Varsai, which is the land records. She's also aiding 4 single women in the neighboring villages to add their names in the land documents. All this, however, has not freed her of the Dakin label. This is a lifelong harassment, she says. A couple of days after Holi last year, her brother-in-law's buffalo entered her orchard and started to rummage around. She was trying to chase it out when he barged in with his wife and son, showering Ratnibhen with abuses. His wife called for them to thrash her so badly that she picks up her ghagra and runs away forever. Then his son slapped Ratnibhen, dragged her across the orchard, and beat her up. They're still trying to scare me away and grab my land, Ratniben says. But why should I be afraid? There is no fault of mine. I'm not going anywhere, she says, and drops the pallu from her head. Yeah, so that's the story. And here, the story, we all understand the witch hunting issue as a gender violence issue. Here, this story also attempts to link it with assertion of land rights by women. And women are branded as witches and subjected to violence when they demand those land rights. And here, the story is not looking to demonize the Adivasi community for this practice, but tries to explore the factors that might be pushing the community to use this as a tactic. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks so much, Monica, for that. And really, women's land rights is the elephant in the room. Like, more than 80% women in India don't have land rights. And we should be talking much more about that. And especially the stories around witch hunting are just shocking and from across the country. Okay, over to Kunal. I believe you also have one story around women's land rights. Go ahead.
Yes, absolutely, Nihar. So, I mean, I come from Bombay and we sort of joke about how every square feet of land here is more than the monthly income of a lot of people who live in the city. So land has been an integral part of my reporting even before I sort of started reporting on issues outside the city. I started off as a city reporter and I was covering the local government here. So I have a couple of stories which is quite on similar lines of the story that Monica just narrated. The first story though is a very interesting one that I came across when I'd gone to Jharkhand sometime last year. I was meeting people. I was going to villages, and I'd heard that a lot of people were complaining that their names had suddenly vanished from their land records. And I said, "What do you mean by them being suddenly vanished?" And they said that my land record that is available online is now my land has been shifted to someone else. And initially, with a healthy dose of skepticism that a reporter always carries. I sort of felt like this might be a localized issue and, it might be as a result of some, local, problems and some local glitches in their systems. But then as I traveled across the state, I found more and more cases of the same happening. And the most interesting to me as a journalist was when I went to this small tribal hamlet, it's called Nayatoli. And I realized that, that hamlet was 108 acres of land that villagers had collectively bought, about 30-35 years ago, and collectively set up their village there. They were landless before that, and they had moved into that land. They had bought that land, and then a couple of years ago, they suddenly realized that land had been transferred back to the original owner, who was who had given up his claims and his rights over the land about 35 years ago. And that perplexed them. And, suddenly overnight they were transformed into, a bunch of landless villagers again. They went to the local tehsildar. He said that, this is what the system reflects and this is what it must be. Then they were forced to go to the collector as well. And, right now they've still, are in a zone where the grievance is still being sort of heard and, they've not found justice yet. But what I did discover through these examples is that this was, state case, but nationwide issue. It concerned a very crucial central government scheme, which is called the Digital India Land Records Modernization Program, where the idea was exactly this, that you digitize land records, but you do it with certain checks and balances in place, where what happens is, all of your land records in the state are then a click away. Just as records of villages in Nayatoli were. The only problem was that the second part of that process, the first part was obviously the digitization of existing land records, which were mostly on paper. But the second part was supposed to be physical, vetting and physical sort of surveying of these land records, which is what had not happened in most cases, especially the ones that I came across. And as a result of that, what you did was, you had someone and government officials later told me the process, and they appointed agencies which basically had to enter data operators of sorts, who enter data from the old land records into the digital system. But a lot of manual glitches at that point, and the fact that there was absolutely no check on whether the data being entered was right and whether it was the updated data, meant that so many people suddenly lost their rights over their land, at least on paper. And then I went on to do that story about how this is creating all kinds of issues because people are then unable to access their land. You know, they're also constantly in the fear that the people who've been named, to be the rightful claimants of the land might then suddenly come up and claim that land, you know. It won't then just be a paper glitch. So that was one issue that I focused on for a story in IndiaSpend.com. The other issue that I've gone back to in the last few years quite a bit is the critical issue of land rights for widows and for women, single women, in an area like Vidarbha in Maharashtra, you know, where you see so many male farmers especially committing suicide because of agrarian distress. My point of inquiry was, you know, what happens to these women, what happens to their families once the men commit suicide? And what I did realize is that often, you know, especially when it was the man who was the rightful, you know, who was the owner of those lands, especially after the man committed suicide, the family members would often gang up against the widow and against the family members and kick them out and ensure that they did not get the land rights, you know, which they were due after the husband had died. And that this particular, bit created immense social conflict because suddenly, you know, these women found themselves to be kicked out of the house, were suddenly found to be on the streets often and, you know, forced to basically start a new life without resources, without money, and without even critical land rights. And that's something that I've also, you know, sort of looked at covering in an article that I did for the South China Morning Post. So these are a couple of issues that I thought would be pertinent for this conversation.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Kunal. I'll just briefly talk about the story that I worked on recently. And I'm just going to share my screen to show some photos. These are just photos that tell the story. So here is a person called Ram Singh Nagvanshi, and he's a Dalit farmer, and he lives in Betul district in Madhya Pradesh. And you can see he's standing in a farm. It's his farm. This picture was taken in January. So he had just sown chickpea, chana, which is a popular winter crop. And Ram Singh belongs to a Dalit community, and Dalits are among the most landless people in India. Now, Ram Singh has this land that you can see, but he's still a landless person. That's because he doesn't have title to this land. And the reason for this is a history that goes back to beyond independence, before independence, and to this particular view, which is just opposite his farm. Now, you can see this land. This land is sort of rocky, undulating. You can see some big trees, some shrubs, some grass. Now, these were common lands or open areas of the village where people would bring their goats to graze. They would cut some wood for furniture or for building a house or for firewood. And all these lands came under the zamindars. As we know, before independence, India had this zamindari system, a feudal system. And some of these lands, which were sort of cultivable, were also taken by landless people like Dalits, Adivasis, and people from the other backward classes to cultivate. And they did so by entering into verbal agreements with the zamindar. So in the same way, Ram Singh's father, because he had to feed a growing family, he took over some of this community land and had a deal with the zamindar, paid him some lagan, that is royalty, and he cultivated this land. Then came independence and the abolition of zamindari. After the abolition of zamindari, all these lands went to the revenue department, which is the department that governs all non-forest land in India. And so, which is the tehsildar and the collector. And the people like Ram Singh, who were cultivating some parts of these lands, suddenly became encroachers on government land. Then what happened was, you can see some big trees on this land. So there were some areas like this that had a lot of big trees, and some were actually forests. So the government in the 50s, the Madhya Pradesh government, decided that let's declare all of this a forest so that nobody cuts the trees and then let's do a survey and find out who was cultivating the land in these areas, denotify the forest status, and give them land titles. It was a very straightforward thing. So they declared everything as a forest, and they did a survey, and they found out who all were cultivating the land, but nobody, they did not actually follow up on the process to denotify the lands which were being cultivated and give out land titles. And so we have Ram Singh standing on his farm in 2020, and his farm is classified as a forest. If you go to the land records website of MP and you put in the survey number of this plot, it says forest, but it's not a forest. And it's been cultivated from before Ram Singh was born, and he continues to cultivate it. And these areas are called orange areas, and they are predominantly in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh, which are the same state. And a large number of people, mostly Dalits, are cultivating this land, have been doing so for a long time. And even though there was a government order to give them titles, they don't have titles. And moreover, they are now on what is legally forest land. And this is Hari Ram, who belongs to the Gond Adivasi group in the same village. And this is his farm. This is also classified as a forest. And why has this not happened? Is because of messy land records and just poor record keeping. Look at this piece of paper. You can see, I have circled in orange, you can see the name Mandari, which is Ram Singh's father's name. So the government would essentially have to go through hundreds of such records, make field verifications, and then start handing out land titles to people. And this is impossible. I mean, if you can't read this on the screen, I couldn't even read when I had the actual original in my hands. This is Anil Garg, who's a researcher who's done a lot of research on orange areas for the last 30 years. And the reason they're called orange areas is because of a story that on land records of villages, all these lands, which are not forests but have been classified as forests, were colored orange by the Patwaris. Although nobody has seen such a colored map, but Anil Garg colored a map on his own just to show the extent of this issue. So you can see this village Dulhara. This is a map for Dulhara, which is a neighboring village. And you can see that most of the land is actually orange area. And this issue is still not resolved. It affects 50% of the villages in MP, 70% of the districts. It's huge. This year there was a task force report of the state government, which said that, you know, we have made mistakes in the past, but we have to resolve this issue. And what has happened is, because the land is a forest land, now people like Ram Singh have started filing for forest rights. And Forest Rights Act gives land rights to forest land. And because he's Dalit, he's counted as a other traditional forest dweller. And he has to show evidence of having used this land and being in this area for three generations. And this is a copy of his application. It was rejected once already. And he is now liable to be evicted from the land because the Supreme Court in 2019, last year, gave a judgment that said that anyone who is on forest land without a title or without recognition has to be evicted. And he's afraid of being evicted from this land. And so he's filed for forest rights, and those applications are still being processed. And this is, you can read more in my story, which was published in The Wire recently. And the reason this is very relevant now is that you saw those people walking back, right? The migrant workers. Ram Singh told me that if this land is taken away from me, I have nothing else over here. I have no way to feed myself. And so I will have to migrate. And people from his area, they migrate to Gujarat, which is like 500 kilometers away to work. And so he said that, I mean, without land, that's where I'll have to go. And so I wanted to show this story just to highlight how a very complex history and very complex systems of land governance don't lead to land rights for a lot of people, and especially Dalits and Adivasis in India. So let's open up for discussion. We can maybe, like, each one of us ask questions. And I really wanted to also, I want us to talk about what this means for the future, right? So now we're living through this lockdown, and we know for sure that there's going to be an economic slowdown. And I'm already reading reports in newspapers about how the government wants to bring industries from China to India, how they want to promote local industries. And apart from relaxing labor laws, which they've already done, land is also something that I'm reading about a lot. And so how will that desire for land come face to face with all these complexities that we've talked about? So yeah, maybe Kunal, if I'm curious to know how the land, the glitches in the land records, what would happen if that land is acquired? Would they not get a compensation?
That's it. I mean, I was about to say, you know, this whole issue has thrown up so many different, it's led to so many fears. There is so much anxiety on the ground. And that's one of the things that I wanted to address, while talking about this story. You have to see the story in the context of what has happened in Jharkhand, especially in the last few years, when you've seen a proposal from the state government to create a land bank for industrialists. And often the land that was included in the land bank was arbitrarily land which belonged to Adivasi communities, common lands and common spaces inside of villages which were marked, lands which were being tilled and cultivated for decades now, suddenly being marked as a part of the land bank. Then you also have the state government, which was very keen to pass two very crucial legislations, which would allow, commercial use of Adivasi land. And that was stalled at some point because, there was a lot of protests from different groups. The governor of the state at some point then returned the bill to the state government again. So that those two laws were stalled. But the point here is this is the context that you anyway created. And then on the ground, when you find that suddenly, your land record doesn't even have your name and has someone, entirely random being named as the rightful owner, that itself creates a lot of anxiety and frustration. And it's unfortunate because I did see so many people who were just grasping for answers, obviously the state government has not bothered to go down to the villages and explain what the glitch is and how this might have happened, or what the process has been, or what the scheme is. For people, it just felt like, they woke up one day and realized that the land had been taken away from them. So you take that and you combine that with the fact that Jharkhand has anyway seen conflict and is continuing to see conflict and also very violent conflict. And the fact that Jharkhand has also seen struggles over land and jungle, zameen, these are all very big parts of not just the political discourse, but the everyday life of Jharkhandis, So when you have an issue like that, which is basically a technical glitch, as the government likes you to believe, it may be much more than that. But when you have an issue like that, and when you combine it with all of, this background, this context about Jharkhand, especially in the last few years, you're basically sitting on a very, on a potentially, explosive situation. Where if the situation is not handled well, and if these grievances are not redressed in a timely manner, you will see people, trying to take recourse to different means to get their grievances heard. So what we've not seen so far yet, at least it hasn't come to my knowledge that there have been instances of this land being acquired, because a lot of this land is also Adivasi land, and it's not possible to acquire this land for commercial use. But I mean, it remains to be seen if those owners who are now suddenly being named as the owners, if they do come forward to take their claim, then there is definitely enough and more scope for a conflict to happen at that point.
Right. And often the states also use laws that don't leave much of a consent for the affected people. I think, Raksha, in your story from Gujarat, it looked like these urban areas were being declared just on the whim of the government. And even village panchayat heads, like sarpanches, were not consulted. Is that right?
Yeah, it totally is. And there is a, it's a bit of a tweak of the law. So the state government took it upon itself to demarcate urban and rural areas, and the minute the state government in its records says that a particular area is an urban area, then you already by default are putting the authority of the urban development authority, the municipality, etc., the urban authorities on it and not necessarily the panchayat. So essentially the panchayats really didn't have much of a say. But yeah, I mean, it's just a quick thing that I wanted to kind of flag here, Nihar, in terms of what you said about how, you know, the current situation, the current economic, you know, kind of a situation that we found ourselves in. Labor law is one of the easiest things that the establishment found to kind of dilute and, you know, make it very fluid. Land laws, I mean, we've seen stories coming in from Karnataka where, you know, lands that were previously deemed agricultural lands and therefore could not be sold for non-agricultural purposes can now necessarily be sold for any purpose. And I also read a report a couple of days ago in which, you know, the lands that are owned by Dalits, you know, previously could not have been sold to non-Dalits. But in specific districts of North Bengal and Bihar, they're considering making that, considering it as a policy. So you never really know when there will be a notification or a piece of law that will come out to that effect. So these are serious dilutions in land laws. And as somebody in our Q&A section has pointed out, land laws are complex anyway. There are several land laws, one overlapping on the other. It's not easy to around which law governs you, regardless of where you are in this country. You're governed by a complex set of land laws. So within that, you know, to make land laws extremely fluid and very, very flexible can be a pretty dangerous precedent. And as we all know, in specific instances, the government, you know, regardless of which government there is, when it makes certain digressions, no matter who comes to power later, they do not take those digressions back, which means that you kind of pushed the spectrum away from you know, clear-cut land laws, which let's say attempts to be an aid to the vulnerable. You push the needle away from that, and the needle is never really going to come back to that space again. So it's kind of important for us to pay attention to that.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, Monica.
I just wanted to add the Adivasi perspective as well here. I mean, it's just a continuation of what you guys are already discussing, that how the government is using this pandemic and this ongoing lockdown also for a diversion of a lot of forest lands. And it is happening really quietly. And they are looking at clearing a lot of projects. And Nihar, you in one of your stories have pointed out that over 190 such projects are on the agenda of the Environment Ministry's expert panels. And they're looking at mining licenses, and they're at the same time, they're also looking at revamping the EIA notification. They're inviting public comments on this notification at a time when people can't hold public gatherings. So sort of taking the public consultation to another level of, it just becomes useless. And also the compensatory afforestation funds, the government has announced some 6,000 crores or something. It's already been a very contentious issue for Adivasis, because it has been talked about a lot about how these funds or this afforestation plans are a huge risk to Adivasi land rights. So right now the government pushing it does not seem like a good idea. It will already, it will increase the stress on the land resources, which is already really low for Adivasis. And the timing of this pandemic couldn't have been worse for Adivasis, because this is the season between March and June is the time when more than 60% of minor forest produces are collected and sold. And it starts with mahua, then currant seeds, tamarind, then comes tendu leaves and sal leaves. And for most Adivasi families, this is the biggest cash income of the year. And they have lost out on it this year. So, and I do understand that at the same time, they need more protection than the non-Adivasi population, because they are also extremely vulnerable to infection. infections and respiratory diseases, because various infections make up for more than 40% of all diseases that Adivasis suffer from, and they have really high numbers of TB in Adivasi community, and it's much higher than for the rest of the country. And 18% of the diseases that Adivasi suffer from are respiratory diseases. So they are extremely vulnerable. So I understand the idea of not letting the traders approach Adivasis to buy minor forest produces might be a good idea. It might be required, but it is hurting the economy. So adding pressure on their land resources, there can't be a worse time than this.
Yeah, absolutely. And in fact, plantations have been one of the exempted activities from the beginning, exempted from the lockdown. And we have been hearing some reports about fencing and plantations going on in forests at a time when it's practically unlawful for anyone to come out and oppose.
Exactly.
And yeah, I think that's really the challenge, that during this time, how do you, as a public, how do you address some of the concerns over the or projects that are happening, or if your land is going to be acquired. And a lot of the projects that are being considered by the Environment Ministry are huge and cover a lot of land. Though, I mean, to be fair, they have postponed a lot of the projects, the expert committees, because of lack of information. But a lot of them are still getting passed. I'm seeing a couple of questions on digitization. And so there's one question for you, Kunal, which says that from Harsh, which says that do you perceive any data privacy issues arising from the digitization of land records? And essentially, I mean, in a conflict prone area, do you think digitization may increase persecution of the marginalized?
You know, I want to definitely highlight this one particular aspect that I did notice in my ground report. Is that what digitization had essentially also done is made it very, very difficult for a lot of the villagers that I met and spoke to be able to then understand the way, you know, their land records have been maintained now. And then suddenly, you know, they had to now rely on someone to basically get access to their land records as well. You know, earlier they would go to the office, they would be able to update it, they would be able to see it, they would be able to pay the tax. But now essentially, because, I mean, especially in a state like Jharkhand, you know, where you still have very, very patchy cellular coverage in most areas, you know, outside of major cities, you know, what this has essentially done, especially for Adivasi communities, is that it's basically, you know, made them wonder again how this whole process works. And some people also told me they felt that, you know, someone had hacked the system and basically stolen their land away. You know, they said that, oh, you know, someone's put their names there. I wonder who it is. For instance, one of the guys that, you know, I interviewed for this story, what had happened was that, you know, there were 5 claimants to his land, you know, which was reflected in the record till 2019. And then when he went to pay his tax to the office, he saw that there the digitization had added one more claimant. So suddenly there was a 6th claimant to the same land. And that, you know, basically threw him in a complete, you know, mystery, because he said, the 5 of us are our brothers and this is family land. Who is the 6th person who's come? You know, so he started hunting in the village. He started asking people, does anyone know a person by this name? And he basically did he was on a manhunt of sorts to understand how did this person get access to his land records. You know, so for him, the understanding that, you know, digitization and the fact that it might have been done because, you know, the government schemes only managed one part of it. They did not follow up with checks and balances and the physical surveys. That knowledge has not reached the grassroots. That's something that also, again, we need to make use of, you know, our local offices. We need to get them to first understand the system and then be able to transmit the knowledge to a lot of these guys. Because many of them told me that when they did go to the, you know, the BDO and then even the Tehsildar, they were not really told or explained how this happened. So, you know, all they knew was that suddenly someone else had their land or someone else had been added as a claimant to their land without really understanding the process. So there's obviously the data privacy part of it, but there's also the part about, you know, access to knowledge about procedures like these, which are so critical to their lives.
Yeah, and it's pretty shocking. In your story, you say that just 2-3% of the lands have actually been surveyed, physically verified. And that's one of the criticisms of digitization of land records. There's a question by Harshil Suresh. What does it make a difference at all? And how far has the government been successful? One of the criticisms that I've heard a lot is that if there are mistakes in the land records, they end up getting sort of formalized. Because when you digitize something, it's intrinsically seen as better or more legitimate. Governments don't invest as much in verifying these records or conducting resurveys, which is something that's required. And also not concluding the title, in the sense having all the claims put together and just deciding, okay, who does this land belong to? And so the government has been pretty successful in digitizing. If you see the dashboard of the Digital India Land Records program, yeah, it's a very good looking dashboard with a lot of high numbers.
But Nihar, it's interesting your point. I was just about to add that you know, that this whole idea about success, it's again, I mean, you know, it's a bit of a misleading term in this context, because if you, as Nihar very rightly pointed out, if you look at the dashboard, you'll see states like, you know, Jharkhand saying we've digitized 100% of our land records, right? So you feel like, okay, this state is clearly doing so well. But when I did speak to officials charge of the program, and most of them spoke on the condition of me not naming them, they said that, you know, we were in a race of sorts, and we had to show that we were done with this part of the scheme, you know. So we had to show that we were quick with digitization, that we've managed it well, and we've done it all. And in that race, they admit that all of these errors could have happened. But the tricky part now is the physical surveys. And believe it or not, but till the time that I was reporting on that story, and I mean, I wrote it, they had still not figured out a methodology as to just how do we send officials on the ground and how do we get these surveys done? Should we do a mix of physical surveys and geomapping? Should we only do physical surveys? Should we only do geo? So, you know, teething questions like these were still not sorted out. So you imagine when the process finally ends, we don't know how long that's going to be. But if you imagine the conflicts that it's going to, it's going to create along the way, till it culminates into something more solid.
Yeah. And what's very strange is that even though the government had a couple of years ago said that in all the digitized records, you should have a column saying the gender, mentioning the gender of the landowner, most of the states have not really implemented this. And so we also don't have good enough data from this digitization on how many women.
Yeah, it's really hard to find gender disaggregated data on women land ownership. It's, I was looking at single Adivasi women holding land, and that was like a really far-fetched idea. We don't even have just like men and women, that kind of segregation of data also we don't have. So that's, and if we don't have data, it really becomes hard to argue this point.
What was the state of land records in the district you reported from, Monica? I'm asking, what was the state of land records? Because okay, like Kunal was in this one forested area in Jharkhand, you are also,
yes,
in.
Yes. So the land records, at least for Adivasis, most of the land records were not updated for 3 or 4 generations. So when a woman wants to add, usually a widow, wants to add her name to the land record, she basically has to go through this entire process where she has to get the family tree done and add maybe her husband's great-grandfather's name to the land record, and then go through the family tree, and then establish how she is a legal heir to that land. And that was the state of land records in Gujarat, at least where I report.
Jumping in here, but like, you know, this is something that we struggle with all the time, which is in terms of accuracy of records. Of course, you know, you guys are talking about specific examples here, but at a broad-based level, I think we all accept that digitization is the way forward, but that has to have a strong lens of verification, resurvey, and particularly community representation. So like for instance in Odisha, when titles were being given out, one of the key features was to actually have the community verify the maps that were being made. So, you know, actually the parcels and which land ends where and which starts where. These are little things which can cause conflicts to last for, you know, generations sometimes. So it's very important that mapping processes become community-centric going forward. And that's at a macroeconomic level, I think, a challenge for all of us to think about how the digitization can, certain technologies of the future can think about these exclusion issues more deeply. Sorry, just...
No, that's really important to know. Although I must say that when you go to the field, a lot of activists say that they are afraid that if you digitize records and put everything up online, it just becomes easier for that land to be acquired. And the more you move towards precision, you know, subject as complex as land, the more vulnerable you're making people. And I don't know, I haven't seen this happen. I don't know how it would happen, but this is something that a lot of people talk about.
No, absolutely. I definitely keep hearing this as well. But unfortunately, you know, if you think about the other side of it, having access to a record which is legally in your name with a clear title also means you're able to get access to benefits. You're able to negotiate better terms on credit that you can access from the market. Sometimes it also means that you have higher social bargaining power in the community. So it's of course the choices that exist to people might not be many, but it for a lot of people, you know, any drives to update land records are met with a lot more enthusiasm, because they recognize that, you know, digitization will be the future in so many ways, with the rest of the economy kind of getting formalized and, you know, a lot of these things going online. There is only so much that you know, one can step away from that reality, fortunately.
Okay.
So I'm not sure about how digitization of this will work in favor of or against the people, but adding their names to land records, that definitely seems to have worked in favor of a lot of women in Gujarat. Now it's like a kind of a movement, and a lot of Adivasi women are part of it, but also Dalit and other women are part of it. And there have been studies, and there is a very clear sense of how it helps. One is one big thing is their social status that changes within the family and also outside. And just access, like Shamili was saying, access to benefits. They can access loans, and Ratniben in my story got PM Kisan scheme funds, and just like their social bargaining power also. And even in terms of domestic violence, when we are talking about women land rights, a lot of studies have shown how access to land rights reduces instances of domestic violence. So access to land rights, yes, digitization, I'm not sure, maybe Nihar and Kunal should be talking more about how, whether that works in favor or not. But one point I want to make about how our judicial system is already overwhelmed with land disputes. So these orange areas and errors in land records, how do you think that's going to work out for us?
Is that a question for me?
Yes, Nihar or Kunal.
Or somebody else. Maybe Raksha, you take that question.
Okay.
You haven't spoken much.
No, I am very, very happy to be listening in. The courts have certainly been overburdened, and it's not at all a secret that close to 50% of the pending cases in all courts put together relate to land in one way or another. So I'm just trying to understand, Monica, if this was something you wanted to touch upon, you know, with respect to digitization, or was this in general the burden that the courts are taking on land record cases.
Yeah, digitization. Also, I was thinking, yeah, because Nihar was talking about orange areas, which also leads to a lot of disputes. Because if, even in Maharashtra, I saw a lot of land which farmers have been cultivating for years together, and then they get, they have what they call fair par, which is like transfer of ownership or something from Forest Department, but then they get a notice from Revenue Department saying, they have it from Revenue. But they get a notice from Forest Department saying it's forest land. So then it goes to the court, the revenue courts. So this is like sort of leading to more cases in the courts, is what I was trying to.
Yeah, no, yeah. You're definitely right about the fact that it's increasing the caseload, the number of cases on the courts. But having said that, I have because a lot of my work has been in Adivasi areas, I have actually seen a certain amount of caginess when it comes to digitization. A lot of people that I speak to are slightly hesitant to move towards digitization, and the singular reason is that they are afraid. See, so here is where power structures work, right? Digitizing something is not necessarily within the powers of specific landowning Adivasi communities, and so they have to then rely on the state, to help them digitize. So in many many areas, it's the Patwari, the local activist, the block development officer, and people within the DC, the district collector's office, who end up helping them digitize. And so there is this high level of mistrust when it comes to trusting the state. So in general, I have seen people be slightly more, I guess they're reserved about the idea of letting somebody else digitize it. Having said that, there are, another like a liaison between the state, that in a lot of these Adivasi areas, the nexus is between the state and, the larger corporations. So, they see a specific company's closer, or, it's a very like a physical encroaching into their lands that these companies do, and they see that as part of, of the state and business nexus. So there is. So I've come across a lot of activists, a lot of villages which have community forest rights, etc. And even certain Dalit communities which have which have recently acquired possession of their lands, be very very concerned about digitization. And there is a high level of distrust. I mean, this is not with specific reference to how it has increased the court's burdens, but in general, this is certainly been my experience.
Okay, but digitization or otherwise, adding the names to land records, like in Satbara, it requires the same set of people, the Talati, the Malmatdar, the block revenue officer, and the district collector. So I think the ecosystem works exactly the same, whether it's digitized or not. So maybe it's also some lack of information. Also, like I'm not sure about that.
I'm sorry to have to come in between, but we've run out of time. And yeah, this was a riveting discussion, but I think we're going to have to wrap it up because it's already past 7 o'clock.
Yeah, I think we're running out of time, but. I personally would love to thank all of you for the time that you have spent with us. But I think more important than that, I'm hearing this across multiple people who participated. This has been very enriching, and sort of, having some of these ground level stories combined with some of these discussions around the bigger ethical questions and some of the questions that often get asked to policymakers. But hearing, your views on it has been very refreshing and different for us, and we really hope that this is the start of a conversation, and we can have many such more platforms where we engage with all of you and sort of keep bringing out some of these stories. But thank you very much for your time today, and I think we are out of time, and we're running into the plenary for the bigger chacha session.
Thank you.
Thank you
thanks
very much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, Nihar, Monica, Raksha, and Kunal for joining us. This is Santosh from the ENCO team. So thanks so much. And Shalmali and the ONI team as well for putting the entire stream together on land and property inclusivity. We have a couple of sessions tomorrow as well, so do tune in for that. And thanks so much.
Thank you.
Stay safe, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.